Hey, look, Jesus said that the enemy came to steal, kill, and destroy. But he said, I have come that you might have life and have it more abundantly. Y'all with me on that? Take a hold of that. Now look, when Jesus says, I came to give you life and give it to you more abundantly, he's not talking about what some of these hucksters talk about, that he's going to drop, you know, $1 million in your bank account. He's saying that you're going to get the fullness of his life. You're going to get the fullness of his peace. You're going to get the fullness of his redemption. You're going to get the fullness of reconciliation to him, right? And that is life. This thing we're living right now ain't life. It's not. Not what he intended. It's not what he wanted for us. And so he is taking us back to the life that he wants for us. And that's what we're going to talk about today. Okay? So, we are in John chapter 3. All right, I'm going to need you class clowns to take it down three notches. Y'all are here. I need y'all to be here. All right. All right. So we are in our fifth week going through the Gospel of John, and we have finally made it to chapter 3. Okay? We're going to look today at a conversation and an illustration. Okay? So in John chapter 3, Jesus is having a conversation with a Pharisee named Nicodemus, and he's giving him what is the ultimate truth of our new reality in Christ. Okay? The Gospel of John does not have any parables in it. Not a single parable. You guys know what a parable is? It's where Jesus tells a story to illustrate the point, the spiritual point that he's trying to make, right? He gives us a story. For dummies like me that can't get the depth of his spiritual teaching without him drawing me a picture in crayon, right? Okay. So since John does not have any parables in it, we're going to get the illustration from the Gospel of Luke. Okay? Y'all good with that? Okay. All right. So we will start off by partially reading the third chapter of John. Now there was a Pharisee, a man named Nicodemus, who was a member of the Jewish ruling council. He came to Jesus at night and said, Rabbi, which means teacher, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one could perform the signs you are doing if God were not with him. And Jesus replied, and he said, very truly, I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God unless they are born again. How can someone be born again when they're old? Nicodemus said. Surely they cannot enter the second time into their mother's womb to be born. And Jesus answered and said, very truly, I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless they are born of water and of the Spirit. Flesh gives birth to flesh, but Spirit gives birth to Spirit. You should not be surprised at my saying, you must be born again. The wind blows wherever it pleases. You hear its sound, but you cannot tell where it comes from or where it is going. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit. Again, Nicodemus said, how can this be? And Jesus said, you are Israel's teacher, and you don't understand these things. Very truly, I tell you, we speak of what we know and we testify to what we've seen, but still you people do not accept our testimony. I have spoken to you of earthly things and you do not believe. How then will you believe if I speak to you of heavenly things? No one has ever gone into heaven except the one who came from heaven, the Son of Man. Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes may have eternal life in him. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. We all know that one. We kind of leave off the second one, and it's just as important. God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already, because they have not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. This is the verdict. Light has come into the world, but people love darkness instead of light because their deeds were evil. Everyone who does evil hates the light and will not come into the light for fear that their deeds will be exposed. But whoever lives by the truth comes into the light so that it may be seen plainly that what they have done has been done in the sight of God. Amen. All right. So we have talked about before that we cannot read and fully understand the Word of God in a 21st century mindset. Okay? This book was written 2,000 years ago. These pages, these things that we are reading today, were written 2,000 years ago. And in order to understand them, we have to read them on the terms that the people that wrote them in, right? What was their culture? What was their history? What were they thinking? How did they understand these things, right? So we spend a little bit of time here talking about the history of this and what this word is actually saying, right? Because then that gives us clarity as to what Jesus is trying to teach us here, right? What he was teaching Nicodemus. So we're talking about being born again, and we've laid a little groundwork over the last few weeks because John, the Gospel of John, takes us through the stages of what Christ accomplished in us on the cross. So real quickly, just to recap, we found out in chapter 2 that his intention for us was that we be one with him, that we would be reconciled to him. That's the way he created us in the beginning. That thing got broke. That relationship got broke. We got separated from him. And he is drawing us back into that relationship through the sacrifice that he makes. Amen? Okay. So he symbolized that by the first miracle he did being a marriage. The second thing he did is he went in and cleaned the temple. And we talked about that, and I know I wasn't incredibly clear last week, but we got through it. So he cleanses the temple, and ultimately he's shown us all these symbols of the temple throughout the course of the Old Testament, over thousands of years, of the sacred space where he wants to meet us, where he wants to be reconciled to us. And ultimately the temple that he wants to use to be truly reconciled to us is our own body, right? He wants to live inside of us. But there's something wrong with us. He has to fix us. And so he's showing us systematically how he's fixing us, how he's taking care of us to make us pure enough for him to live inside of us, right? And so we see in the temple symbolism that the problem is this flesh and this blood. And so through the temple ceremony, he shows us those things have to go away, and we have to approach him in the spirit, right? So this third stage that we're looking at now that John's talking about is that we got to be born again, right? And to be born again, something else has to happen. We got a lot of opinions on that one. You got to die. Okay? Now that's weird. That's weird that he says you got to die. But Jesus says in here, as he's trying to explain this to Nicodemus, he says, you're looking for something that you can see. This thing I'm talking about, you can't see it. It happens. The wind blows where it wishes to blow. We hear the sound of it. We feel it. But we can't see it, right? And so he's telling us, this thing that I'm going to do in you, you're going to feel it. You're going to hear it. But you're not going to see it, right? It's a thing that comes by faith. And that faith is backed up by what I'm doing in you, right? Y'all follow me on that? Okay. So I want to just take a minute and look at how first century Jews would have seen death and sin, okay? Because those two things are completely intertwined. They're almost synonymous. I mean, like they, when they talk about sin, they understand that death comes with sin. And when they talk about death, they understand that death was born from sin, okay? Now, we've got a real convoluted idea of what sin is, okay? Somebody shout out to me what a sin is. All right, or a specific sin. When you kill somebody, somebody else. Lying, somebody else. Bearing false witness. Who was over here? Huh? Little baby. What is it? Yeah, okay. All right. Envy? Okay, good. All right. Now I'm gonna break your paradigm. Paradigm means how you think, right? Those aren't sin. Those things aren't sin. Those things are what are the result of sin, okay? All of those things are manifestations of a disease that exists in us, okay? So let's talk about what sin is, okay? Sin, when the Bible talks about sin and the Bible talks about ungodliness, the Bible talks about wickedness, when it talks about transgression, all of those terms are different ways of saying separation, okay? So every one of those terms that God seems to concentrate on the most and talk about the most, wickedness, sin, ungodliness, transgression, are all about our being separate from Him, okay? And when we're separate from Him, we read in Galatians last week, when we're separate from God, we put our reliance in our own flesh. And when we put our reliance in our own flesh, then we feed what our flesh wants. And what the Bible says our flesh wants is it wants sex and drugs and rock and roll, right? That's what that's what the flesh wants. The flesh craves things that feed the flesh. And so Jesus says we got a problem here. We've got to kill that thing. We've got to take away the reliance on this physical life and put our reliance in a spiritual life. We got to change our connection. We got to plug into a different socket. Amen? Right? We got to get our power from somewhere else. So I'm going to read you a couple of things. Man, I got a bunch of verses here. And I had to write them down. Okay? So listen to what Paul says. Listen to what Paul says in Romans 5:12. He says, therefore, just as sin entered the world through one man, Adam, right? And death through sin. And in this way, death came to all people because all sinned. Okay? So sin is separation from God, and when we separate ourselves from God, we die. Okay? Now, we're still walking around, right? But the moment you're born, you start to die. If you look at medical science, it says that our every cell in our body dies and is shed and is reconstituted, some of them on an annual basis, some of them every 3 years, some of them every 7 years. But our body is constantly dying. It's constantly giving up its life force. God told Adam and Eve in the garden, he said, if you eat of this tree, and like I said, we're not going to debate what that tree was about. Whatever it was, it broke the relationship that we have with God, right? And maybe we will talk about it one day. We're just not going to talk about it today. Today, okay? But God said, if you eat of that tree, you will surely die, right? He created them to be eternal. He created us to be eternal, to live forever, okay? But when the relationship, the source of our life, was broken, we were separated from the Spirit of God, we die. We're no longer spiritual beings, we're human beings, right? Okay? And I'll say this, because we need to get this down deep inside of us too, right? Okay, you are not a human having a spiritual experience. When you come to Christ, you're not a human having a spiritual experience, right? You are a spiritual being having a human experience, okay? Everything changes, right? Your life comes from Him. Amen? Did I make that clear enough? Okay. Okay. So let's just read a couple more things. So it said, therefore, just as sin entered the world through one man and death through sin, and in this way death came to all people because all sinned. So that separation caused the death. We no longer have the life force of God. And then God has had to spend these last several thousand years reconciling us back, showing us how He's preparing us to get that life force back, to take His Spirit back, right? Romans 5:15 says, but the gift is not like the trespass. That means God giving us life, that's the gift. The trespass was Adam's sin. For if the many died by the trespass of the one man, how much more did God's grace and the gift that came by the grace of the one man, Jesus Christ, abound to the many? For 1 Corinthians, for as in Adam all die, so in Christ all will be made alive. Right? Once He's cleaned out this temple and He lives inside us, He makes us alive, right? The first man became a living being, the last Adam a life-giving spirit, right? Let's see how many more of these I want to do. I don't know if we do, because we're not even through the conversation. We still got to get to the illustration. All right. I'll read this in Romans 6. Or don't you know that all of you who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into His death? Okay? We were therefore buried with Him through baptism into death in order that, just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. For if we have been united with Him in a death like His, we will certainly also be united with Him in a resurrection like His. For we know that our old self was crucified with Him so that the body ruled by sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves to sin, because anyone who has died has been set free from sin. Now, if we died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with Him. For we know that since Christ was raised from the dead, He cannot die again. Death no longer has mastery over Him. The death He died to sin once for all. But the life He lives to God. Amen? That's complex, but it's simple. He is inviting us not only to take part in the life that he wants to give us, but he's inviting us to take part in the death of what he gives us, right? It goes back to that double jeopardy thing, right? Once you've died in this life, right, then you can no longer be held accountable for the things that are done in this life, right? And as mystical as this may sound, that's what he's telling us is happening to us when we join him, right? That old man has been put away, dead and buried, and we are brought into new life. We are born again. Life starts over with a new life-giving force, the Spirit of God. Amen? Okay? Are y'all following me? Okay. All right. Couple more, and then we'll move on to the illustration. Therefore, my brothers, you also died to the law through the body of Christ, that you might belong to another, to him who was raised from the dead, in order that we may bear fruit to God. I have been crucified with Christ. It's no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. The life I now live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. Amen? Okay. So, this entire section where Jesus is talking to Nicodemus about the need for us to be born again, put away that old life and live in this new life, is this idea, this reality of being born again. Okay? Now, I probably haven't fully explained that. I've done the best that I can. Okay? But in Luke, Jesus gives us an illustration of this. Okay? So we're going to move on to that. And hopefully, that does a better job than me. Amen? Okay. All right. You know what? You won't hold it against me. No, hey, please don't. Please don't. God uses the foolish things of this world to confound the wise, right? He used the dummies of this world to so that he can be glorified, right? All right. So, Luke chapter 15. It says, now the tax collectors and sinners, and we're going to go through this slow, okay? Right? Hey, Andres says, oh, boy. If you need a potty break, just raise your hand, okay? All right. Now the tax collectors and sinners were all gathering around to hear Jesus. But the Pharisees and the teachers of the law muttered, this man welcomes sinners and eats with them. All right, so let's identify who our audiences are here, okay? Tax collectors and sinners, okay? Here's the way that those folks would have been identified at that time, okay? Because these Pharisees knew exactly what we're talking about, right? People that are separated from God are considered sinners. It doesn't really matter what they did or if they did anything. If they had any kind of physical malady, right? If they were blind or deaf or they were lame or paralyzed, they were considered sinners and unclean to the Pharisees of that time because that made them unclean, unable to go in and worship in the synagogue, be in the presence of God, right? They're separated from God, okay? So if you were poor, you were considered cursed. Y'all follow me? I mean, like, we need to relate to this stuff, right? Anything that made them different, that they were considered to be cursed of God, because what they believed is that there's this really angry God that puts his wrath on people he doesn't like, right? That he gives them maladies, and therefore God doesn't want those people near him. They're misreading God's intention and his nature, right? Okay? Because they're stuck in this religious symbolism. So, let's put a fine point on it. None of us down here would have been welcomed into the synagogue, right? We don't fit the bill. We would have been excluded from going in to what they consider to be the presence of God, okay? So you're all sinners, right? Okay? It also includes the tax collectors, and these would be people that it would have bought the right to collect the taxes for Rome, right? So it would have been their brothers and sisters. It'd be like Gerald had bought the right to collect the taxes, and so he has to give Rome $2, but he's going to charge me $3, right? And he's going to keep $1 for himself. So these people were hated as traitors, right? So they also could not go into the presence of God, right? So we have got, what you got?
What makes them the ones that made that rule that run the synagogue?
Yeah.
What made them so holy that they got to go into the
synagogue? Yeah. Oh, okay. So he's asking, so how did we come up with who made the rules, right? Yeah. Yeah. So their power came from their structure and their wealth, right? And it came the old boy network, right? Okay, we see that today, right? This shouldn't be crazy to us, right? That there's a certain structure that excludes a certain sector of society, right? This is our thing, and you're not invited, okay? And so many of them, it was because they were priests, because they were born into a certain family, and they were the arbiters. They were the ones that deciphered the law and handed that down, right? So they decided who was good and who was bad. But here's the thing, is Jesus is coming in to shake all this up. And every time he comes across them, including this one that we're reading here, he is shaking up the structure and saying, you're misrepresenting me. You're not telling these people who I am, right? And you don't even recognize who I am. God is standing right in front of you, and you don't even know that I am he. Amen? Right? So you have built this whole thing that you believe is the way that you get to God, and you don't even realize God came to you. He's coming to you. So he's shaking up their whole paradigm, right? And it's pissing them off. It's making them really mad because this breaks down their whole power structure, okay? That everybody's included? Crazy talk. Dirty people are included? Are you kidding me? I went to a church yesterday. I hadn't been to a church because I do this 3 days a week, right? So we do the Friday Bible study, we do the Saturday church, and then we do Sunday church over at Town Twin. And I haven't been able to go to church, Lisa and I, for a long time. Because we're busy, and I'm grateful. I say, go to a church. This is my church, right? Right here is my church. This is where I go to church. This is my church family, right? But I went. Yeah. Hey, thank y'all. So I go into this church yesterday, and God bless them, man. They're the sweetest people. But as I walked in there, and everything was marble and shiny and clean, and I walked into the room with all those folks, and all I'm thinking is, man, everybody's got their shoes on. This is crazy. Right? Right? So anyway, shaking up the paradigm. Okay, let's move on. This is going to take forever. All right, so Jesus told them this parable. Because the Pharisees are coming and they're saying, look, why would you do this? Why would you hang out with these folks? Because what you're doing is if they touch you or you touch them, then you're unclean too, and you can't go to church. So you're putting yourself in the position where you're separated from God, and therefore you're dead, right? Because the Pharisees would have considered them all dead. The Pharisees would have looked at themselves and said, we're following the law, we're making the sacrifice, we're doing this, we're doing that, we're doing all this stuff for the letter of the law, so we got a chance. There's a chance that we're going to get to God at the end of the day, that we're going to be part of the resurrection and we're going to get to God. But these people have no chance. and you're putting yourself in a position where you have no chance. So they're murmuring against him, right? So he tells them this parable. He says, suppose one of you had 100 sheep and you lose one of them. Doesn't he leave the 99 in the open country and go after the lost sheep until he finds it? And when he finds it, he joyfully puts it on his shoulders and goes home. Then he calls his friends and neighbors together and says, rejoice with me, I found my lost sheep. I tell you that in the same way, there will be more rejoicing in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who don't need to repent. Amen? Amen. So that's the first thing he tells them, right? The second thing, he says, or suppose a woman has 10 silver coins and loses one of them. Doesn't she light a lamp, sweep the house, and search carefully until she finds it? And when she finds it, she calls her friends and neighbors together and says, rejoice with me, I found my lost coin. In the same way, I tell you, there is rejoicing in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents. So the Pharisees are nervous at this point. He's like, oh, he's talking about us. That we don't care about the lost sheep. We only care about ourselves. We're the 99, right? But in their minds, he's still acknowledging them as the 99. The 99 sheep that didn't need repentance. The 9 coins that weren't lost. So they're still puffed up, like, okay, cool. Yeah, he's kind of on our side, but keep going, right? So it says, then Jesus continued. He continued his talk. He continued to explain this idea to him, and he did it this way. There was a man who had 2 sons. The younger one said to his father, Father, give me my share of the estate. So he divided his property between them. Not long after that, the younger son got together all he had, set off for a distant country, and there squandered his wealth in wild living. Okay, we'll stop there, because again, we got to read it under the terms of the person that wrote it. Understand what's going on here. You got 2 sons. The younger one comes to his father, and he says, give me my share of the inheritance. Here's what he's saying to his father at this point. He's saying, I'm going to sell you my birthright. I am going to sell you my name for my portion of your estate. Okay? Now, being the younger son, he would have only been apportioned a third of the estate, because the oldest son gets a double portion. Okay? So the oldest son would have got 2/3 when the father passed. The younger son would have gotten 1/3. This guy's saying, give me mine now, but I'm giving up any claim, any future claim that I have on your estate. Now, here's the position of the younger son. The younger son would have never been given the land that the father lived on. That would have gone to the oldest son, right? The younger son would have lived on that land, helped take care of that land, been able to benefit off of that land, but he wouldn't be the guy carrying on the name of the family. So in his mind, he's thinking, and y'all follow me on this, right? Put yourself in the story. He's thinking, I'm never going to be the guy. I'm never going to be able to meet the standard of my older brother or my father. I will always be secondary, right? These are the lies that we tell ourselves. I might as well just take my piece now and give up any claim that I have to actually being a member of this family, right? So I'm going to take mine now, right? Now, look, Jesus told Nicodemus in that John chapter 3. He said people love darkness so much, they want to live in darkness because they think when they live in darkness that their sins and their actions are hidden from God, hidden from the Father, right? So it says that this young man gathered up his stuff within a few days of getting his portion, and he moved to a faraway land. He moved out of the sight of his father and his family. He moved to a place where he could act however he wanted and not be under any condemnation that his father would see what he was doing, right? And he said he lived wildly. We find out later that he wasted all of his money on gambling and prostitutes and drinking and all that, right? So, but he feels like he's got free rein because he's separated. I can do my own thing because daddy's not right here with me, right? Y'all following me here? Okay. So, it says, after he had spent everything, there was a severe famine in the whole country, and he began to be in need. So he's out of money. He's in a foreign land. There's a famine in that land, right? There's no abundance. There's nothing for him to get. There's no family. There's no attachment. It says, so he went and he hired himself out to a citizen of that country who sent him to his fields to feed the pigs. Okay? Let's analyze that for a second. When it says that he hired himself out, the actual Greek there is he sold himself to. He attached himself to this man from another country, right? Because when we separate ourselves from God, that in itself is the sin, right? Separating from God. But what we generally do is we don't just leave God, we attach ourselves to something else. The idols of this world, the things of this world, the pleasures of this world, the gods of this world. We attach ourselves to those things, right? And so that's what he's doing. He attaches himself to this man, and that man sends him into the fields to feed the pigs. Now, he's a Jew. He can't even be around pigs. Pigs make you unclean, right? You can't eat pork. You can't touch pigs. You can't raise pigs. Can't have anything to do with pigs. So this guy has not only sold himself to somebody else, but he's now put in a position where, again, according to the law, he has completely, he hadn't only given up his family name, he's given up any hope that he would ever be able to be connected to God. Amen? Okay. So, he longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating, but no one gave him anything. Anybody relate to that? You're in the field. You're feeding the pigs, and the slop starts to look good to you. Right? We become so debased in our thinking, so separated from the Father, that any crap looks good to us. But nobody will give us anything. Amen? Now, pivotal verse. When he came to his senses, he said, how many of my father's hired servants have food to spare? And here I am starving to death. I'm going to add a word there. When he came to the end of himself, when he came to the full knowledge that within himself, he couldn't do it. when he started to die, he started to come back to life. Amen. So when he came to his senses, he said, "How many of my father's hired servants have food to spare, and here I am starving to death? I'll set out and go back to my father and say to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you.'" He's practicing. He's practicing his speech. Any of y'all do that? Like, before we start to talk to God, we practice talking to God. When I get there, I'm going to tell him this. When I finally get down on my knees, I'm going to talk to him this way. "Father, how does he say it? I am no longer worthy to be called your son." This is his practice. "I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants." And so he got up and went to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and turned around and went in the house. And he sent a couple of servants out to him and said, "Look, you can't see your father this way. You got to go in the barn and get cleaned up. And then you've got to go out in the field and you got to work for 8 years. Because this guy you sold yourself to needs to be paid off." Right? "And once you've done all that and you've got all that paid off, then maybe you can start working in the field with your brother. But you better act right." Who's going to stop me? Are you guys going to stop me? Y'all know this story, right? This ain't the way it goes. This is the way we think it goes with God. We think that he's going to send somebody out to meet us in the field and tell us we got to clean up our act before we can be in his presence. Nuh-uh. Man, I thought I was going to have to keep going. All right, now. I'm going to tell you how the story really goes. It says, "So he got up and went to his father. But when he was still a long way off, his daddy saw him, and he was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son, and he threw his arms around him, and he kissed him. Then the son said to him, 'Father,'" he's doing the practice speech, "'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to his servants, 'Quick, bring the best robe and put it on him.' When he put that robe on his back, he got his name back." That's what that symbolized, is you're back in the family. Shut up. I don't want to hear it. I don't care where you've been. I don't care where you've done. I'm just so glad you're back. I'm glad you're home. So he put a robe on his back, and he said, "You're part of the family." And he put a ring on his finger. And let me tell you what that ring symbolized. That ring symbolized the full faith and credit of the family name. Anywhere he went, anything he wanted to purchase, anything he wanted to do, that guy that he probably ran away from, that he sold himself to as a slave, that ring signified that guy would be paid off and he'd be set free. Amen? So he's got his name back. He's got the full faith and credit of the family name back. And he says, "Put some shoes on his feet." When we come back to Jesus, we got to come empty of ourselves, broken and dying. And then he lifts us up, and he puts a robe on our back and a ring on our finger, and he puts shoes on our feet, right? And then he tells his servants, "Go kill the fatted calf. We're going to celebrate." Because, guys, something always has to die. A sacrifice always has to be made. Blood is spilled. And Jesus did the spilling. He paid all the debts. He gave everything that was required. Tetelestai. It's over, paid in full, it's finished, right? But never forget the price that he paid. Never forget what he gave up to get us back to himself, right? So, lost my place. For this son of mine, now, bring the fatted calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and is alive. He was lost and is found. So they began to celebrate. Now look, see, at this point, see, the Pharisees that he's telling this story to, man, they're feeling good, right? Like, man, he is letting these folks have it. He's telling these sinners exactly how they act, right? And then he says, oh, yeah. Meanwhile, the older son was in the field. And when he came near the house, he heard the music and the dancing. And he called to one of the servants and asked him what was going on. And the servant told him, your brother has come. And your father has killed the fatted calf because he has come back safe and sound. And the older brother was angry and refused to go in. So his father went out and pleaded with him. But he answered his father and said, look, all these years I've been slaving for you and never disobeyed your orders, yet you never gave me even a young goat so I could go, he could celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours who has squandered your property with prostitutes comes home, you kill the fattened calf for him. Why is this important? Why is it important for all of us here, right? Because us sinners know we need a Savior, right? We know that we need the mercy of God. But sometimes we get real religious and we forget that we all need to be born again. You notice that this son wouldn't even go in the house where the presence of the father was, right? And the father came to him too, and it says he pleaded with him. Come on in. Join us. One of you can sit at my right hand and one of you can sit at my left hand and we can celebrate together, right? But the father finishes up this way, and we'll finish up this way too. He said we had to celebrate and be glad because this brother of yours was dead and he is born again. He was lost, and now he's found. Amen. Father, we thank you, and we praise you, we glorify you. Lord, call us all to come to our senses, come to the end of ourselves, and come back to you. When we make one step towards you, you'll come running. You just want us to come home. You just want to be with us. You just want us to live and exist and abide in your presence. We thank you and praise you for the sacrifice that you made, for the lengths that you've gone to draw us back and show us how much you love us. We give you all the praise and glory and honor in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.